quantum computing related. And the first talk is by Dee Fang, who will tell us about algorithms for quantum Hamiltonian simulation.
All right. Thank you so much for the introduction, and thank you everyone for coming to the talk. So basically, if my understanding is correctly, then I think that the purpose of the workshop is to introduce myself to you guys. So in that sense, this slide is perhaps the most important slide out of my talk. So as you can see, my name is Dee Fang. So please feel free to call me Dee. I'm a mathematician assistant in both the math department as well as the Simon's research pod for quantum computing. And this figure that I created basically summarizes my research areas. I work in the intersection between mathematics and quantum, especially when there is a computing aspect to it. So specifically, actually, I'm trained in numerical analysis as well as semi-classical analysis. That's a type of PDE analysis. And I work on these PDE problems with application to quantum science. So the specific type of interest that I'm working on can be summarized into the three different types of quantum problems. Number one is classical algorithm for quantum dynamics. Number two is quantum algorithm for classical problems, such as say classical differential equations and learning tasks. And then the focus of the talk today is quantum algorithm for quantum dynamics, which is what I'm going to briefly discuss. All right, as I realize that there are only two talks in our workshop regarding quantum, so I'm going to do a really sort of naive, if my quantum friends expert quantum friends in the audience, and you may be not as happy with me, but we can certainly discuss afterwards. So I plan just to do a little bit of a super quick high level overview of quantum computing, starting with quantum computing 101, and then just tells you what is the problem that I want to deal with, and what is the difficulty, and the fact that I did it without discussing more of the detailed analysis of it. All right, so let's start with this very famous Richard famous quote. Well, I think it's a consensus in quantum community. If you give a general talk, you should have a Feynman's figure somewhere in the talk. So here is it. The point is that if we talk about the original motivation of quantum computing, it can be dated back to this the 80s. The story is basically that if we think about nature, it really acts quantum mechanically, which is terribly high dimension and has impossible, physical for classical computer to handle. Then Feynman basically suggests that if that's the case, then why don't we make our computational device quantum so that it acts quantum mechanically, hopefully we have the right degrees of freedom to work on this problem. So essentially what Feynman suggests is to look at this quantum simulation problem, also called Hamiltonian simulation problem. The setup is really simple. We are just giving us a certain description of the Hamiltonian, which can be time dependent. And the purpose of the task is basically we want to produce a final state up to certain procedure. Mathematically, we can certainly write down the differential equation, which is just a Schrodinger equation. And as some examples of this Hamiltonian, for example, it can be a Laplacian plus potential, where the Laplacian is a kinetic part and potential is the interaction. For example, if we talk about molecular dynamics, there's this multi-body Schrodinger equation, and this x, you should view it as terribly high dimension in the sense that for molecule, if we have electrons and nuclei, if the total number is eta, then the dimensionality of this problem is 3 eta, and that alone you discretize it in each of the dimension, it's a terribly high dimension. So curse of dimensionality is of course something one should worry. All right, then the task of Hamiltonian simulation is really simple. Suppose H is time independent, we can easily write out this exact unitary, which is just the exact solution. The task of Hamiltonian simulation is that we want to construct an approximate unitary that can be efficiently implement on quantum computer. By efficient, I will explain very soon what we mean by the efficiency, so that when measuring certain norm, we can get certain precision. So this is it, very simple to explain. Well, on the other hand, if H is time dependent, the story is really the same, just that you have an integral, you have a time ordering term, but nevertheless, the story is really the same. All right, so now let's talk about why and why. First of all, why quantum computer? Well, Feynman says something, you'd better try it, but if there's no practical mirrors, then maybe you shouldn't pour money into this field. So I'm going to just give a really oversimplified, not so accurate, sort of a high level idea of what a quantum computer is. If you think about quantum computer, maybe this is what pop up in your mind. This is one of Google's quantum computer. You may think that quantum computer is this super dedicated piece of device that's caused you a fortune to make. then the point is why, right? As an oversimplified picture from scientific computing point of view, I'm just going to say that for the purpose of the talk, that I'm going to say quantum computer is this device that can calculate this matrix vector multiplication, this matrix operation super fast. You may wonder how fast is fast. If we just directly do the calculation, then we know that the cost is going to be n squared. If you think about what is the most celebrated algorithm last century, it's going to be arguably the FFT, fast forward transform. What that's basically do is that for certain structures of A, instead of n squared, you can get n log n. So you get almost linear, that is very significant. You may wonder what does quantum computer bring on the table, that it get rid of this log and maybe make n squared root, and what's the gaining? The gaining is that it's actually getting rid of n. So it's actually this log scaling. That's why people are so excited about it, this potential exponential power gaining from quantum computer. All right, then now why Hamiltonian simulation? As we said, that it serves as our original motivation of the quantum computer. Certainly coming from physics, it has great physical and chemical application. And what I also want to say is that this is actually a very commonly used subroutine for many quantum algorithms, such as matrix inversion. As you can see, there are many applications scientifically as well. All right. So I won't tell you the, there are a great many of advances recently in this field. I won't discuss the details of all these methods, but the message is that the underlying difficulty of the problem actually increases when the problem become more and more highly oscillatory. So suppose this H has a very large norm, as we know that this exponential negative IHT is wrapping around by itself super fast. So this is one source of highly oscillatory. The other source is on top of that, if Hamiltonian is time dependent, it's very fast, then there's a second source of highly oscillatory. Existing algorithms typically have a polynomial dependence of the cost or either one of them. So for the simplicity of the talk, let's forget about the derivative for the moment and just talk about operator norm of H. All right, so the major takeaway is that this is a typical cost that shares by all of the algorithm. It has some polynomial dependence on this operator norm of H and this poly n, where n is the number of qubits in the problem, which is the log size of the Hilbert space. So this is what we got is poly log. I just want to say that for bounded Hamiltonian simulation, so if a Hamiltonian simulation where H is bounded operator, this story is already complete. The best known algorithm already matches the theoretic lower bound. So the story is already complete. What the talk for today is that we are going to discuss what about unbounded operator. Apparently, you can see that if the problem, the operator is unbounded, this guy is going to be infinity. So if you talk about the cost, this guy will overcome this poly log and will become the dominant part of the cost. Actually, it's actually infinity. That how can you actually even talk about the cost? Well, you can certainly ask me, well, fine, the unbounded operator, the norm is infinity, but why should I even care? Is there any application if I really look at this problem? The answer is certainly yes, this is a molecular dynamics. I just put some graph to entertain my audience. This is an electronic structure problem, and this is some recent machine learning task that can be all represented in this form, a Laplacian plus potential. Laplacian is unbounded, its operator norm is infinity. You can still argue with me that even on classical computer, we never directly simulate unbounded operator. We always discretize it. After discretization, isn't the norm? It's just a finite constant. Why should I even care? So that's just illustrating a super naive one-dimensional case. You can see that the size of the Hilbert space is capital letter N, and the operator norm of this Hamiltonian H is also capital letter N. This will give you a cost that is poly N, but remember the goal is really poly log. So this is what is the challenge comes here. So I hope that I gave you enough motivation of what is the major challenge and why this is a meaningful question to study. And the question is the main question is really how to get rid of this strong independence, hopefully make it log. And the answer is yes, I won't go into like how I construct the algorithm, what is the circuit construction, what is the complexity analysis, just to tell you the answer is yes, we can do that. And we also have a very surprising super convergence results that's highly non-trivial, and I won't have time to discuss that. You are very welcome to discuss with me afterwards. So this is a complexity. These are not empirical bounds. These are, analysis bounds. And you can see that our algorithm outperforms in terms of this specific unbounded operator task, outperforms all all the state to the art bounds of existing algorithms. All right. Just to say that this particular the algorithm that I talk about, Q-hop, is actually, remember, I said there are two oscillations. The other oscillation comes from if there is a T dependency in the Hamiltonian. So we also want the derivative dependence maybe going to be log. So our algorithm actually checks this box as well. So it's actually the first algorithm can simultaneously handle these two problems. So it's especially valuable if we have unbounded operator. So with that, that's pretty much my talk. And this is the main result that I discussed. This is another result, which I said previous result in the table. And these are some of the two recent work where we propose a so-called observable error bounds, which is a framework of analysis that can give you further improvements if you look at Hamiltonians on bounded operators with in the setting of molecular dynamics. So with that, I want to thank you for your attention. If you are interested in knowing me more, you are welcome to discuss, or you can check my webpage, and that's it. Thank you.
Thank you very much for the talk. Questions? Yeah.
So I have two questions. First question.
The first question is regarding the result where you mentioned with the unbounded operator. Is that only applied to the case where the it has needs to have a Laplacian operator there, or it's like general unbounded?
Yeah, that's a great question. So actually, you can handle any the case of there is a polynomials of the derivative. So as long as a PDE, and actually this Laplacian plus potential, as I show in the picture, is actually the physical ones. So you can handle the cases where there's a polynomial of the momentum operator can be multiplied by some time dependent control terms, and plus say the potential which has a time dependent part as well, or say in molecular dynamics there's no time dependence. Either way, this is a actually interesting problem to study. And I think a relevant issue is also that we know that in general it's impossible to improve regarding this operator norm if we consider arbitrary. The reason we can improve on this particular, say, this physical Hamiltonian is because it's not a general result, say, for any arbitrary Hamiltonian. Because for any arbitrary Hamiltonian, it's guaranteed by no false forward theorem. We know that there is a lower bound that you cannot go over this polynomial dependence of the norm of it. So it's really using the structure of the problem to gain better results. That's thank you.
Okay, maybe the next speaker can
set up and someone else question. Go ahead.
What was the cat supposed to be? Like you had a cat next to the logo.
Oh, it's a Schrodinger's cat. It just
the most famous cat
just
in the world.
Just for entertainment.
Was it
dead?
Yeah.
Any other question? Okay, if not, for the final talk of the session, Quantum Scientific Computation by Jinpeng Liu.